I'm trapped. If I leave, I'm alone. Oh, God. In, out, in, out. I never saw Venice.
Ipa! Ipa! Trapped forever. It's all come true.
That crazy old man in church was right.
Raise your hands. Without the attitude?
People, people, I have an important announcement. I have just perfected an acid-firing super drill, which can cut through anything.
It is cool.
It's right there, just outside of the dome.
A rainbow, as it's called in modern science, is defined as a band of colors formed by the refraction and reflection of the sun's rays. This band always conducts itself in the same pattern. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. Accordingly, the colors are given their perception based on their varying wavelengths. Red has the longest wavelength. Wavelengths stimulate the retina in the eye. This retina converts the light it receives into signals the brain can process for visual recognition to occur. Light means to shine. The word color means to appear to the mind or bring forth into the light. It is etymologically the same exact word as the eye, which is defined as the mental and spiritual faculties or showing mental qualities. Matthew 6:22 and Luke 11:34 state, "The light of the body is in the eye." So once again, this is modern science corroborating what the Bible says. Ephesians 5:13, "But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light, for whatsoever doth make manifest is light." Moreover, modern science tells us that the recipe for these rainbows are sunlight and raindrops. However, it is generally sunny when rainbows appear. The scientist's explanation for this is that rain has often just passed and water droplets are still in the air. Whether that's the case, one thing for sure is that clouds are always present. Now men see not the bright light which is in the clouds. Job 37:21. The question remains, if that is true, light is reflected and refracted through raindrops, why the perfect band? Why do we not see bands of rainbows going in all directions? Wouldn't the light still need to reflect off something? Hence the dome, the anti-gravity magnetic field believed to encase the Earth. This field arcs high above the Earth until it reaches the conjugate region, the place where the heaven meets the Earth. Amos 9:6, "It is he that built his stories in the heaven and has founded his troop in the earth." When I looked up the word troop, it meant aguda, meaning to bind with an arc. This heaven is the firmament, defined in Job 37 as a molten looking glass, a mirror or reflective surface. A reflective dome mirror would produce the bow we see. Many ancient cultures believed that this was the earth's true shape. Egyptians described it as an egg-shaped watery abyss. It wasn't until 1830 when Satan, in the form of Apollyon, was said to have appeared to Catherine Laborn and called himself the Immaculate Conception. He requested that an image be made of him standing on a globe. No marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. 2 Corinthians 11:14. In 1899, scientist Nikola Tesla began his plans for a wireless transmitter that would power the whole world without heat. A huge tower would transmit signals. His design was based on a flat earth with a dome. The project proved to be very costly, so he enlisted the help of John Jacob Astor, a financier, and his nemesis, J.P. Morgan. Tesla admitted that this alliance was one of the worst decisions he's ever made. After Astor went down with the Titanic, the project was demolished due to lack of funds. Sometime before 1946, the U.S. military received intelligence that UFO aircrafts had been seen in Antarctica. So under the guise of exploring the unused resources in the South Pole, the Navy went on a voyage to retrieve these aircrafts in a task called Operation High Jump.
The scenario, we were originally talking about the spiriting out of the two spacecraft out of Berlin before the Allies arrived. We said that they were put aboard two submarines. They spent 6 months at sea, and they finally landed in Argentina. Now, from that point, they were taken into Antarctica, into a section of Antarctica called Queen's Maud's Land. And there they disappeared, and they were not heard of for some time. Now, intelligence sources, and of course, I was in the intelligence business at that time with the agency, reports indicated that they were in there and they were operative once again. Now, there was a major concern by world powers to go in and capture the technology and the two spacecraft which they knew were in Antarctica. And the intelligence reports indicated that one known as Admiral Byrd was to be recommissioned and he was to be sent in there to retrieve the two saucers and also the technology and personnel associated with it. Later reports indicated that Admiral Byrd was given 8 months and unlimited funding to go in and pull this thing successfully off.
What they found was an ice wall and atop a glass barrier. They thought it to be the anti-gravitational magnetic field, a part of the German super technology.
What do we know about the Operation High Jump, about Admiral Byrd's expedition in the autumn of 46, the early spring of 47, to the South Pole? But this is an expedition that has been almost forgotten, and it's very hard to come up with any information about it. The few articles that were published at that time in, let's say, National Geographic magazine, would not give any clue to the real intention of that expedition. However, recently we discovered a unique documentary film in color, 1 hour long, made by the U.S. Navy. It was a massive naval operation that involved an aircraft carrier, several battleships, an armed submarine, and probably another 20 supply and battleships. It involved 4,000 troops, U.S. troops, and the rumor is that there were also British and Russian contingents within these 4,000 troops. It was a massive naval operation. It was not as it has been presented to the public, that it was a peaceful expedition to explore the natural resources of the South Pole. They descended to Little America, which is the place of the previous Admiral Byrd landings on the South Pole. And then they started a massive overflight over the whole area of the South Pole, trying to locate the German base that was established there almost 10 years earlier. The Germans started somewhere in 1936-37, seriously exploring the South Pole, and by the time the war ended, the rumor is that they have established a massive underground colony with at least 100,000 scientists, researchers, elite SS troops, children from Hitlerjugend, the young boys and girls that were to become the seed of this new and colony that was to be built under the principles of the super race selection. What was it that Admiral Byrd found on the South Pole? Incredibly enough, in an official American Navy documentary film, we found footage of what Admiral Byrd found on the South Pole. He found giant freshwater, never freezing lakes, with areas around them that were free of any snow. And in that film we show footage of the Navy planes landing in these lakes. But even more so, he found to his amazement that his planes were disappearing very quickly. A lot of his planes were attacked by anti-gravity devices that were operated by the Germans there, by anti-gravity saucers. A lot of them crashed into invisible barriers and disintegrated in mid-flight. This is an indication that the Germans had already perfected the force field shields, and they were up and operational around the German colony at Neuschwabenland. When he was retreating, basically the whole operation lasted for 1 week. They started in the at the end of February 47, and by the first week of March, they were through with the whole operation, and much, much earlier than scheduled, and they departed. And in an interview at Buenos Aires on his way back, Admiral Byrd made the incredible statement that the Third World War would probably be with an adversary coming from the polar regions of our planet, an adversary that has the ability to fly unobstructed from pole to pole. He was referring to the Germans at their south polar colony at Neuschwabenland that were operating their anti-gravity craft with impunity and could fly circles around the globe and, of course, would shoot out of the sky any of the attacking American planes.
Now, if you watch my previous video, you know why it's important that the Germans were the ones that had this super technology, as they called it.
Aboard the Mount Olympus, the Navy tries out one of the most important experiments assigned the expedition. Can men survive in freezing water? Men from Mars, members of a special underwater demolition team, wear the new cold water rubber survival suit. In contrast to these skylarking youngsters eating ice cream in the ice, men in ordinary clothing are paralyzed in 6 minutes and die very quickly thereafter. Yet these sailors, wearing only underwear beneath their survival suits, stay in half an hour and come up chipper and warm.
They were the ones that were said to be in contact with the beings that lived in the inner Earth, the ones that gave humans all this super alien technology in exchange for us people to experiment on and to feed on. In another attempt to explore this invisible field, the military launched a project in 1962 called Operation Fishbowl, where high-altitude rockets were sent into space only to have them stopped by an invisible barrier high above us.
Although radar on the damp ship and Johnston Island showed no gross refractive effects from any of the bursts, preliminary results indicate a refractive jitter problem under certain conditions, involving a rapid fluctuation in the apparent angle of arrival of returning radar pulses. It was present on all events, but most pronounced on bluegill and kingfish. Another electromagnetic effect important to DOD's search capability is clutter, which could hamper radar performance for a period longer than other effects. Radar clutter is caused by ionized air, ionized bomb debris, and electrons trapped in the magnetic field. All these materials reflect radar energy, giving rise to false targets on the radar scope. Our first consideration is the reflection clutter from the fireball itself. Confined to the visible fireball, it is most pronounced when a well-formed fireball is generated. Another problem is presented by field-aligned clutter, observed in that region of the sky for which the observer is at right angles to the magnetic field lines at E-layer heights, and within an azimuth of about 15 degrees to either side of magnetic north.
Interestingly, as the rockets burst at varying altitudes, it produced a different color. Some observers saw green and blue circular regions surrounded by a blood ring, as well as orange, pink, and white striations.
Gaining a vertical scale of information for various altitudes and yields. Included in the wide assortment of fishbowl projects were thermal studies on Iburn, investigation of debris distribution, and documentation of the nature and transport of the magnetic field disturbance generated by high-altitude detonations. On Operation Fishbowl, nuclear detonations rent the sky 5 times over the Johnston Island area, each time during the hours of darkness. Of the 5 fishbowl shots, the highest burst was the 400-kilometer starfish event, launched by a pod-carrying Thor missile. Its yield was 1.4 megatons. In addition to the local phenomena, the transport of bomb debris and other charged particles in the magnetic field produced colorful aurora arcing into the northern and southern conjugate regions. Checkmate, like Starfish, did not display a well-defined fireball. Checkmate exhibited a moderate aurora seen in both the northern and southern conjugate areas. Kingfish's fireball was well-defined, and its aurora moderate. From the refraction effects from a nuclear burst are of concern in the high-precision target tracking of ICBMs in the terminal phase. Although radar on the damp ship and Johnston Island showed no gross refractive effects from any of the bursts, preliminary results indicate a refractive jitter problem under certain conditions, involving a rapid fluctuation in the apparent angle of arrival of returning radar pulses. It was present on all events, but most pronounced on bluegill and kingfish.
Are rainbows proof of the dome?